morning on the back of your worship folder for where we're going as we begin a new sermon series this morning. This is us. In fact, this is us. Maybe you're one of the us's who wake up sometime in the middle of the night. And there, coming into the midst of your mind, is that unwanted guest. But it doesn't go away. No matter how hard you try, no matter how much you want it to, it lingers. It plays tricks in your mind. Maybe for you, it shows up in your mailbox. That place where, where just like 3 weeks ago, like, was filled with Christmas cards and pictures and celebrations, and now it's filled with things from things like American Distress and all the other places that you went that are filling up your mailbox, reminding you of how holly and jolly the season was, and the expense that holliness and jolliness cost you. Maybe it shows up in the doctor's office. A routine appointment, a routine checkup, and the doctor says to you, "I think we need to run some more tests." Maybe it shows up at work. Things changed when you were gone on vacation. You wonder, am I next? Maybe for you, it's a feeling that comes when the uncertainties that you planned for in life are not turning out like you thought they would. You look around and you're not sure what to do next. It's that old enemy that we've all experienced in many and various forms. The enemy of fear. Fear that shows up uninvited, but doesn't seem to know when they've extended its welcome, when it will leave. Fear's power. Think of the things that we find ourselves fearful of economies, fearful of Social Security, fearful of our pensions, fearful of our retirement, fearful of our border, fearful of wars, fearful of your job, fearful of your family, fearful of broken relationships, and your list can go on and on and on. The things that remind us of this world that there are things to be afraid of. Yet there's this command, at least that's how we usually think of it, that comes out in Scripture, both in the Old and New Testament. It's spoken by prophets and angels and even God himself, a command to fear not. And I think sometimes we hear that command, fear not, and we think to ourselves, well, how can I fear not in a world that's filled with so many things to be fearful of? And I want to challenge you as we begin this series this morning is that if you hear that command, fear not, as simply a command, that what you might be dealing with is not just a struggle or a fear, but rather an identity struggle. Because I think when we hear that phrase, fear not, it's not just a command. You can take it at that. But when you hear who says it to you, why they say it to you, you can receive it by faith as a beautiful invitation. An invitation to live in a way that many people in the world can never even imagine living in. I know there's things to be fearful of. And absolutely no doubt about the things that we're afraid of. A national crisis happening, deportations and occupations are looming, war on the horizon, walls being built and torn down, foreign invasion, just a matter of time, people deciding for themselves what's right in their own eyes. 2,700 years ago, that was exactly the case. Oh, I know you might have been thinking of another place in another time, I don't know, maybe, but 2,700 years ago, in the nation of Israel, the time of the prophet Isaiah, that was their greatest fears. He was talking to a people 100 years before they would face deportation and exile into foreign lands and territories. Isaiah described the people of his days as every man doing what was right in his own eyes, deciding what their own right and wrong was. And Isaiah enters into the scene and he delivers a message. It's not a popular message because he calls the people to account and he reminds them of the God who has called them by name and declared them to be his own people. And he reminds them that their father, their heavenly father, he's a good father. And good fathers discipline their children. Good fathers care so much about their children is that when they see things are wrong in their lives, they're not going to just let them keep going down their path. They're going to discipline them. And Isaiah tells the nation of Israel, discipline is coming in the form of the nation of Babylon. And it's a tough discipline. A discipline that will find themselves losing their nation, losing their territory, losing their place of worship, losing some of their very own lives. As many go into exile, and many more are deported to another nation as slaves. And this is the context in which Isaiah proclaims his message. You know, maybe there's nothing new under the sun. The only thing that's new under the sun is you and me. Maybe if our eyes are open to what God says to the nation of Israel, when he commands them, and better than that, invites them to fear not, that perhaps our eyes can be open to. Because what the nation of Israel is experiencing and struggling with more than anything else is an identity, a crisis about their identity, about who they are, who their hope is in, who their trust is in. Because the identity crisis happens when we start identifying with the creation and not the creator. When we find our purpose, our hope, our rescue and our savior in the creation instead of the creator. Creation can be good things. After all, it's been made by the creator. But that's not where our identity is found. And so Isaiah takes some time to explain to the nation of Israel, by the time we get to Isaiah 43, some encouraging words. That even though they find themselves in desperation and in this identity crisis, there is a reminder, there is a hope about a God who isn't simply waiting for people to change their minds, to get their lives in order. He's not even waiting for them to repent, because he's a good father. And he gives his children what they need, even before they need it. Isaiah 43 declares to us these words, beginning at verse 1, if you want to follow along, page 767, your pew Bible, or your outline there as well. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel. And I'll stop right there. Before we even see what the Lord who created you and formed you has to say, we have to recognize what Isaiah is doing here, what the Lord is doing here, is he's making a pretty bold statement. He says, I created you. I formed you. Do you recognize how incredible a statement that is? I'm going to guess you don't. No matter how many times you may have read that before, or even if it's the first time you've heard it, you probably don't get how incredible that statement is. So I got an illustration to try to help you understand that, how incredible that is. Let me illustrate it this way. I have in front of me a priceless work of art. I borrowed it from the Brownsville Arts and Heritage Museum. They lent it to me. And you can look at that. I mean, you recognize just how priceless that is. I'm going to start the bidding war. $100, $100, $100, $100, $200, $200, $200 over there, $300. Nobody's raising their hands. Come on, this is a priceless work of art. So you're looking at it, this piece of creation, you're thinking to yourself, well, yeah, it's nice, but it's really just pencil on a piece of paper with some words, and I don't know, maybe it's abstract art, I can't really understand it, but it doesn't seem that great. Now let me tell you something. Let me tell you who made this. Let me tell you the creator of this object. The creator of this object is my 5-year-old daughter, Tabitha. Now let me ask you again. $100. No, just kidding. But it changes. See, if you just saw this lying on the ground and you just saw it on the side, you would think, oh, that's pretty nice. But you wouldn't think much of it. You might not keep it. You might not think of it as having any value. But if all of a sudden I tell you that it's been created by my daughter, or it's been created by your son or your daughter, or let's make it real, it's been created by your grandkids, how much of the value goes up? How much more important does it become when you see what has been created in the eyes of the creator and not just the creation? How much does the value change when you see the Creator say and declare, I made it, I formed it, and if I can get you to believe that about a piece of artwork, can the God the Father who formed you in your mother's womb get you to believe that about yourself? That's what the psalmist declares. The psalmist declares that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. But you know what else the psalmist says? Surely I was sinful from birth. Sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Fearfully and wonderfully. Sinful from conception. And we live in that tension of those two. Made by the Creator. Stained by our sin. And as Isaiah begins his proclamation, he says this. The Lord says this, even better. He says this. Come, let us settle the matter, says the Lord. You've got a struggle that you're living in. I want to fix it. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are as red as crimson, they shall be like wool. I'm going to bring a change about because of what that sin has done to your life. And I'm not just your Creator, I'm going to be your Redeemer. And I want you, before I tell you anything else, to know who you are. I created you. I formed you. And so when we live in that identity for the nation of Israel then and for the people of God now, in that identity that God has given to us, then that next thing that comes out of his mouth when he says, fear not, becomes an impending, it becomes inevitable. It becomes a reality. Because it's not about our strength, it's not about our might, it's about the one who has called us his very own. Just look at that list of things that he says in there in Isaiah 43, verses 1 and following. For I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they won't overwhelm you. When you walk through the fires, you will not be burned. The flame will not consume you. Notice what the nation of Israel has done so far in this text to make themselves right with God. They have done absolutely nothing. Nothing. Dark days are coming, Isaiah says. Things to be fearful about. They're going to be evicted from their homes. They're going to be, the nation's going to be destroyed. The walls of Jerusalem are going to be knocked down. The temple is going to be robbed and desecrated. The people are going to be put in exile. They're going to go into captivity, and many of them are going to die. And then God says, fear not, because I will be with you. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. And no matter what, that's kind of the idea. No matter if it's the water or the fire, man means anything. Nothing will change my presence with you. And notice he says it's a when. Not a question if. Not a question or perchance. It's when. It's an inevitability. It's a certainty. It's like Jesus who says, as he's near the end of his ministry, he says, in this world you will have trouble, to which we all can like say, well, at least I might not agree with everything the Bible says, but I can definitely agree with that. We will have trouble. We can testify to those troubles. But the promise is the presence. See, if you count up the number of times in just those first seven verses of Isaiah 43, there is 26 times that the word you is used, or a form of it in the verb. You can't always see it in the English. And I know the tendency that we have sometimes when we read the word you in the scriptures, we kind of think of it in the Texan terms. We kind of think of that it really should just say y'all or all y'all or something like that. That it's like referring to like this big crowd of people, because surely it's not referring to me, because if you knew the stuff that I was going through, if you knew the fears that I have, if you knew the struggles I have, that really doesn't apply to me. But I got to tell you, that's not all y'all. That's not a y'all. It's a you. It's a singular you, which means you can take your name out of it. You can take the you out and you can put your name in. You can say, Nathan, I have redeemed you, Nathan. I have called Nathan by name. Nathan is mine. Nathan, you're going to pass through the waters, and Nathan, I'm going to be with Nathan. You can do that. You can go through that text. You can see that this is a personal thing that God is declaring. It's an intimate thing, not just to a nation, but to a people. Then and now, a people that God is willing to exchange his life for. people. That he's inviting them to fear not. Not because there's not scary things in the world. No, there is. He's admitting that. He's acknowledging that. But he's saying, you don't have to be afraid. Because who you are, you're mine. I've called you by name. And I love how he continues. Because you are precious in my eyes. And I love you. And I'll give men in return for you. And peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I can't believe, you know, back in the previous slide, I can't believe the statement he makes there. That you're precious in my eyes. You know, Isaiah is speaking this to a nation that has made for themselves a bunch of idols that they trusted. Stones and other people and other things and even other principalities, other nations that they're putting their hope and they're idolizing. And yet Isaiah reminds them that the God that they worship, the God who has called them by name, that he has eyes and ears and he does stuff. And incredibly enough, that you are actually viewed as precious in his eyes. How incredible is that? How valuable are you? How famous are you that the creator of the world thinks that you're precious in his eyes? Not just my daughter's work as precious in my eyes. How much more you, son, daughter of God, are precious in your creator's eyes. You're so precious that Isaiah says, he's willing to exchange people for you. And that happens in the small scale for the nation of Israel. But it happens in an even greater scale in the person of Jesus. That he's willing to exchange his own life for your life. Your life has a value and a treasure and a worth. Because of the one who has paid the price for you. The price is paid in full. It's for you personally, not just all y'all. It's for you. And when we live in that reality, when we live in that truth, then that second statement, when he continues to go and he says, fear not, for I am with you. Well, he continues on with it. He says, fear not, I'm with you. I will bring your offspring from the east. I will bring it from the west. I will say to the north and give up, and to the south don't withhold. I love that part. It's almost like a Dr. Seuss. From the east and from the west and from the north and from the south. Everybody, right? Bring my sons and daughters from the ends of the earth, wherever they are, anyone who is called by my name, who I created for my glory, who I formed and I made, it's for you. And Israel couldn't even realize how great that promise is, so that when Jesus arrives on the scene and the message and the mission of the church is proclaimed, that it's not just for one nation and one people group and one location, it's a worldwide phenomenon. That's why Jesus says the last things out of his mouth before he goes into heaven, go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. It's that baptism that he connects us to. Personally and intimately calling us by name. We heard it this morning in that Romans passage that Josh read for us. In Romans chapter 6 verses 3 and 4, he says these words, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized in Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too would join him in walking in that newness of life. Our identity is confirmed in the water, in the word of our baptism, where God declares to us that we are his children, brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ himself, children of the Most High God, who he declares to be precious in his eyes. No, sometimes we don't feel very precious. And you know why we don't feel precious? It's because we look at the creation and not at the creator. We look at ourselves in the mirror and we see not just the reflection, but we see back at us all of our brokenness, all of our sins, all the things in our lives that are out of control and out of order. And we realize how unprecious we are in our own eyes, but we need that reminder that it's not our eyes that we're looking at here, it's God's eyes, and we are looked at as precious because he sees us through the lens of his son, Jesus Christ, who he's joined us to in those waters of baptism, personally declaring to us to be a part of his family, to find our identity in him. You have an identity. It's been given to you. And it's in your Creator, not in the creation. I was reminded of that how powerful that is. It's something that's not just in the scriptures, but this idea that we're searching for our identity. It's played out, especially in media. And one of the things I saw recently that I was reminded of it is how many of you remember the movie? I think the first one came out in like 1995. How many of you saw Toy Story? Or Toy Story 1, Toy Story 2, Toy Story 3, next summer Toy Story 4. Okay, so like most of you have seen it, so you know the kind of premise. If you haven't seen it, let me just give you kind of a quick kind of overview, is that there's this little boy, and his name is Andy. And Andy has a bunch of toys. And Andy continues to get more and more toys, and his toys are unique in that they come to life. They actually can talk and have adventures and all these things. Buzz Lightyear and Woody, the cowboy dude, and all these other things that are part of this whole realm of the toy story. But one of the things that the struggle, the plot of most of the toy storylines goes something like this. There's a new toy that enters into the toy chest, and the struggle is, does Andy still love the existing toys as much as the new toy? Can Andy's love be spread to other toys? Or other plots are, can Andy still love me if I'm not very lovable, if I'm broken? Can Andy still love me when he's growing older? Because a toy that's not loved, a toy that's not played with, is no toy at all. It doesn't have a value. And so over and over again in these stories, one of the characters, one of the toys, it's not real, by the way, it's just all made up, okay? And then one of these toys, they have to remind each other that they have a bit of an identity crisis. That while the world around them seems crazy and chaotic and confusing, their identity, who they are, doesn't change. And the way they know that it doesn't change is they have to look on the bottom of their shoe, there, right there, Andy writes his name on all his toys. And as they go through that struggle, they remind each other where their identity is, who they belong to. Here's a little montage to get you thinking.
We wouldn't even be together if it weren't for Andy. You're both Buzz. You and Jesse. Whose name is written there?
Maybe Andy doesn't care about us anymore.
Bottom of their shoe and finding a name. And as cute as that might be in a storyline, how much more so, how much greater, that more than a boy playing with a toy is a creator of the world who chooses to call. call you by name, who knows everything you've done, who is precious in your eyes, and those eyes, they've seen a lot. Those eyes have seen things you wish he wouldn't have seen. It doesn't change the way he feels about you, because they're eyes that look in love through a font, through a cross, through an empty grave. He says, you belong to me. You're a child of the Most High God. You're a brother, sister, Christ. Made so not because of what you can do, but because of what he can do and chooses to do for you. It's the identity that he wants you to live in. Because his invitation to you in the midst of a world with many things to be afraid of is he says, you're mine. You get to fear not. What would change? What would change if we really took him up on what he says about us? What would change if we really believed what the Creator, by the way, he's never lied. I just got to point that out. What if we really believed what he said about us? You're mine. And as Jesus declared, as he gives that gift of baptism, as he gives that command to the church, the very last words out of his words, as he says, go and baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then he says these words. He said, surely I will be with you always. What if we live in that reality that Christ says we're already in? You know what? It might just change. It might just change the things that we're afraid of. Because our identity is not found in the creation around us, for good or for bad. Our identity is found in the Creator, who loves us with an everlasting love, and who's willing to welcome us home all day long. Let me pray for us. Father, how great it is to belong to you. Lord, there's so many things that, like ancient Israel, we'll put up in our lives as idols. So many other things that we try to find our identity in. Things that may be good and right. Things that you may have created, but yet, if we find our identity in the creation instead of the Creator, we know it will eventually let us down. We'll be fearful of what we will lose. But yet, Lord, you see us in our fear, and you choose to jump in with real flesh and real blood and the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. Who took upon himself on the cross the sins of the whole world, all of our brokenness, all of the things that we think don't make us precious in anyone's eyes. And he paid the price for them, his death. And that by his resurrection and through the gift of baptism, he invites us to be united to him, to find a new identity as children of the Most High God, sons and daughters of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And Lord, we want to live in that reality. So, Lord, for those things that are in our lives, that are fears, we pray that we can see them as the lies that they are and find our identity and our trust in you. So that then, as we go into this world, we can live in a way that's different than the world lives. Not in fear, but in faith. And we know, Lord, our faith will never be big enough, but we know that you are more than big enough, for you have overcome the world. And you are that object of our faith. So help us to cling to you. No matter what may come, knowing that we are yours. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand? Receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you.